It's that point in growth where you are stuck. You're in between childhood and adulthood. You are trying to work your way through something, right? You're trying to work your way through, you know, the social structure of the world. Who are you?
And that's a normal teenager thing, you know, and relationships end and friendships end and people go off to college and you lose touch. And then you throw a cancer diagnosis on top of that and it's like everything else takes a back seat.
About 10, 12, maybe even 15 years ago, some of the initial data started coming out showing that these patients weren't just doing as well as younger patients and older patients. And so we started looking at that and saying, why is this population not doing well? There is good evidence that they're not being enrolled in clinical trials as much. The biology of their tumors may be different, but there's also a very strong psychosocial component to the reasons that they kind of flounder with their diagnosis.
The primary, you know, like mental health diagnoses that my patients have are anxiety, depression, and adjustment disorder, which of course makes sense because you have a cancer diagnosis and you're forced to adjust. And I often kind of tell them that those are the unexpected side effects, right? Like they're not directly related to the chemo where you might feel nauseous, but it comes with the territory of having a serious illness. I've had 6 cancer diagnoses throughout my life, and I've been treated at Yale every single time. My personal background in being a cancer patient has really helped me connect with the patients and really helped me fill that role in a way that I don't think many others could. Having been a young adult with cancer and having seen the gap that they kind of fall into, whether if you're an adolescent in a children's hospital, you feel a little bit too old for the clinic, and if you're, you know, a 20, 30 something on the adult world, you feel too young for everything. I think the hardest part for me as a teenager going through cancer treatment was the isolation I felt in both my treatment aspect and my personal social aspects.
And when someone's in a state of depression, loneliness, anxiety, that compliance, that ability to do what's prescribed diminishes. And so there are certain cancers that we treat where we really need these patients to be taking their oral medications when they're not there. And if they're not taking those medications, the cancer will come back. And so there's a direct play in there of an inability to treat the cancer due to the mental health issues.
Adolescents don't want to come back to the hospital when they don't have to, and they don't want to interact with each other while they're too sick. Dr. Marks and I had kind of these ideas of forming this virtual reality young adult support group. It provides a different level of immersion that maybe a Zoom support group wouldn't. For this specific age group, they like to feel like they're with other people and that almost they could reach out and touch them if they wanted to. We worked with a company to help kind of build this software from the ground up where we kind of designed the space. It's, you know, very calming earth tones, and there are 4 chairs and then my chair, and it allows patients to connect with others from wherever they are while feeling still very immersed and like they were in the same room. The VR headsets are designed where every, you know, kind of ounce of light from the outside world is cut off, and it's 360, so you can look up and down and behind you, and the room is all encompassing, and you can see my avatar and you can see the other 3 avatars. The mouth moves when you talk, which is pretty cool. They have handsets so they can control kind of, if they're talking with their hands, you can see that. You get kind of some unique body language that comes across.
And so we started putting in place a formal institutional review board review, protocol review, really getting this going as a true clinical trial to give it some teeth and actually show that we were proving its efficacy. We started with some very objective measurements. We looked at depression, anxiety, and resilience before and after groups. what we have seen, a very objective response and a true improvement is in resilience, which is huge. So resilience really is a way to say, how are patients kind of dealing on a day-to-day level? How are they getting through their illness? And we saw a difference before the intervention and after. After the intervention, they were measuring on a resilience scale as being more resilient. And so that's huge for us. That shows real clinical progress.
It's a safe space where they feel like I can share anything, and it's adolescent, young adult oriented, so it doesn't feel like a children's hospital. It doesn't feel like you're in the pediatric ward or anything. It's just, it's age appropriate care. I think that is the best way I can describe it.
This is something that patients who may not have the means to come into the city, come into support groups, come to the hospital on a weekly basis, are able to participate in. So we're able to reach those in different demographics, whether it be socioeconomic or geographic. I think what I'm most excited about is that we have the ability to continue to expand this, making it a standard of care, making it standard practice to use these groups in these populations to benefit patient care.